Good morning to all of you. I'd like to thank SRA for organizing this webinar, and thank you all of you for taking time to register for this event. The webinar today is regarding my PhD study titled Improved Design of Robot Evaporator Through Experimental Investigation and CFD Modeling. I'll give you guys an outline of the presentation. I'll start with the introduction of the topic. I'll discuss the multiple effect evaporation and the robot type evaporator that is dominant in Australia. I'll describe the scope of the research. The project has been carried out in four phases, and I'll talk about each of these phases as we go along. I'll talk about the progress to date on the project phases, and then I'll talk about the future work in the final year of this PhD. And then I'll finish the presentation with some acknowledgements. All right, so multiple effect evaporation was developed by Norbert Rilex in the Louisiana sugar industry in order to achieve efficient usage of steam. So the figure shows a quadruple effect where juice at 15 Brix and 97 degrees Celsius is brought into the first effect and is heated with process steam, which is at 120 degrees Celsius. Now, using the graduated pressure difference between the process steam and vacuum in the final effect, the vapor in the first effect is used to heat the juice in the second effect, and so on until the final effect, where the vapors from the final effect are condensed in the barometric condenser. The syrup that is leaving the final effect is at 69 Brix and at 59 degrees Celsius. Now, multiple effect evaporations can be used with any evaporator type. Since this study is regarding robot evaporators, I'll put some light on the robot type. The robot evaporators is a well-accepted and understood design, not only in Australia, but in most overseas sugar industry. The Australian sugar industry currently operates with 423,000 square meters of evaporator heating surface area, of which 97% is in the form of robot evaporator. The industry has installed 8 robot vessels in the past 7 years with a total surface area of 34,000 meters square and cost in excess of $40 million. In the next decade, it is expected that the factories will install more evaporators and replace the old ones to increase this energy efficiency. Hence, it can be seen that the robot evaporator is the dominant form in Australian sugar industry and just justifies this study. Now, the figure shows an example of a robot evaporator with the conventional tube dimensions of 44.45 millimeter of outside diameter and 2 meter length. The figure shows the steam inlet from the steam annulus and the juice entry into the vessel from the bottom of the vessel. The condensate leaves is taken off from this end, and the juice is again taken off from the bottom, calling it an under and under configuration. Okay, so the parameters that are used to define the performance of the evaporators is heat transfer coefficient in watts per meter squared per Kelvin, which is given by this equation, where Q is the heat transferred in watts, A is the area of the vessel in meter square, and delta T is the temperature difference between the heating steam and the juice in the vessel, also called as the driving force for heat transfer. Hence, for an evaporator with a fixed area and a fixed heat transfer coefficient increases for a smaller delta T. A second parameter which is used to define the performance of the vessel is the vapor condensation coefficient, which is kilograms per hour per meter square. This VCC is closely related to heat flux. The relationship between heat transfer coefficient and VCC is given by this equation. All right, so the objectives of this PhD study is to understand the boiling mechanism in rising film evaporators, to investigate the use of different tube dimensions for different vessels, which is not commonly undertaken in Australia. So this PhD study is looking to develop an improved design of robot evaporator, seeking better performance in terms of heat transfer coefficient, at the same time reducing the capital cost associated with the designing, fabrication and installation of the equipment. Alright, so let's get into the phase one of the project. The phase one was the capital cost model. Now, when we are designing an evaporator, it is important to understand the cost implications for evaporators, especially with calendrias having tube of different dimensions. A capital cost model was developed, which determines the relative cost of constructing and installing robot evaporators with the same heating surface area, but with different tube dimensions. In this study, evaporators of 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 and 5,000 square meters are investigated. The main design parameters for the vessels of all the four heating surface area are calculated for calendrias comprising of three tube lengths and three tube diameters. The table on your right shows tube length of 2, 3 and 4 meters and tube diameter of 38.1. 44.45 and 50.8 millimeter. A code is given to each of these tube dimension, where the letter in the code represents the tube diameter, where S is for small diameter 38.1, M is for medium diameter 44.45, and L is for large diameter 50.8. The number represents the length of the tube. I'll give you all a couple of seconds to just have a look at this table and register these codes, as I'll be referring to this course fairly during the whole presentation. Okay, so a tube layout program which was developed in at the Sugar Research Institute is used to determine the diameter of the vessel and the number of tubes. The input to the program is the tube length and the tube diameter and the target heating surface area you're trying to achieve. The tube layout program calculates the vessel ID and the number of tubes for a given heating surface area and the tube dimensions. Now, all of these designs are based on the SRI type, which include a central downtake of juice, steam annulus for the radial inflow of steam. They also include mini downtakes, which are given in this top section. Alright, so once the model was developed, we start to look at the different outputs from the model. So first we'll look at the number of tubes. The number of tubes is calculated for all of these four heating surface areas and with each of these tube dimensions. Now it is seen that the large diameter and 4 meter tube has 56% fewer tubes than for medium diameter 2 meter tube for the same heating surface area. Now, calendrias with large diameter and 4 meter tubes will provide cost savings in drilling and honing of tube plates and inserting and expanding tubes. Now, the vessel inner diameter is an important parameter, as it determines the footprint of the vessel, it determines the mass of steel, the volume of juice held in the vessel, and the contents of design for the supporting structure and foundations. The diameter of the vessel is reduced by 33% when small diameter 4 meter length tubes are used as compared to the medium diameter 2 meter length. As an example, if you look at the evaporator heating surface area of 5000, which is the red bar, the vessel inner diameter is 9 meters for tube dimensions of M2 and is reduced to around 6 meters when tube dimensions small diameter and 4 meter tubes are used. Some assumptions that have been used in the capital cost model. The labor requirement to manufacture vessel is said to be 70 man hours per ton of steel, which includes cutting, bending and welding of steel. The labor cost is around $70 per man hour. The fitting of tubes, which includes the placement and expansion at the top and bottom plates, is 5 minutes per tube. Some other assumptions have been made for the workshop overhead cost, the project management cost, and the profit margin of the company. All right, so putting all the cost together and the assumptions, the vessel cost is expressed relative to the cost of vessels with empty tube dimensions for the same heating surface area. So one clear observation what we see here is that vessels with empty tube dimensions are more expensive than all other tube arrangements except for the large diameter 2 meter length tube. Talking about the mass of the vessel, the mass of the vessel contributes towards the cost of the foundations and structure to support the vessel. It contributes towards the insulation cost, the pipe work, instrumentation and the control cost. Now comparing the small diameter and 4 meter tube design with the medium diameter 2 meter tube design, we get a reduction of 40% in the mass of foundation and structure is achieved. Talking about the juice volume intensity, which is defined as the volume of juice held in the vessel per unit heating surface area. Now the juice volume intensity is reduced when small diameters and 4 meter tubes are used as compared to the medium diameter 2 meter tubes. Reducing the juice volume intensity reduces the resident time of the juice in the vessel. We know that sucrose degradation is a function of juice conditions and resident time. And the vessels in the early stages hold juice at high temperatures, close to 114 degrees Celsius. Reducing the juice volume intensity reduces the resident time and the chances of degradation in the vessel. Alright, so coming to the conclusions from the phase one of the project. Relative to the M2 tube design, vessel cost savings can be 12% with 44.45 millimeter outside diameter and 3 meter length, which is the M3 tube dimension. Around 15% with 38.1 millimeter outside diameter and 3 meter length, that is the S3 tube dimension. And around 20% with 38.1 millimeter outside diameter and 4 meter length, which is the S4 tube dimension. Now the vessel diameter for all of these about three tube dimensions have smaller diameters which have considerably less mass on the structure and foundations, and additional savings through reduced installation cost can be achieved. Alright, so that's the end of phase one. So the phase one of the project talks about the capital cost of the equipment. But cost is one thing, what about performance? The heat transfer coefficient of the tube dimension with all the one that I discussed in the previous phase except for M2 are not known. So there are three main objectives in the phase two of the project. Undertake experimental investigation for all the tube dimensions mentioned in phase one. Develop a regression model for heat transfer coefficient optimum juice level using the data from the experimental work. And understand the boiling mechanism in the rising flame evaporators. Alright, so the experimental investigation were undertaken for a single tube evaporator rig. 9 tubes of 2, 3 and 4 meter length and 38.1, 44.45 and 50.8 millimeter diameter were tested. The evaporator rig was operated over a wide range of operating conditions which are typically encountered in factory vessels. And the condensate rates were measured at 4 equal lengths of the tube. Alright, so the figure here shows you a schematic diagram of the single tube rig. The evaporator tube here is encased into the steam jacket and 4 gutters are placed equidistant along the length of the tube. Now these gutters collect the condensate from each of these sections and are collected into the condensate containers placed at the bottom. A fifth condensate container is provided to collect the condensate that condenses on the inner walls of the steam jacket and have no role in the heat transfer in the tube. Now the juice which is boiling inside the tube, the vapors are formed in the headspace. These vapors are taken forward to a vapor trap to trap any of the entrained juice along with the vapors. The vapors are then taken into a heat exchanger which are condensed and brought back again into the juice tank. Now, before this condensed vapor is added to the juice tank, it goes through an immersion heater, which heats it up again to the boiling temperature of the juice, so that the temperature in the juice tank does not fall below its boiling temperature. To increase the Brix of the solution, a connection was added to remove excess water. An external downtake leg with a shutoff valve is provided to act as a downcomer when the rig is operating. The noxious gas line is connected to the vacuum through this pipeline. Alright, so the experimental program that was undertaken for all the tubes is shown in this table. So for each of these tubes, three Brixes at 20, 35 and 70 were tested. Each Brix had four juice levels, and at each juice level, tests were undertaken at two levels of headspace pressure, and two levels of delta P. Now the selection of this juice level, the headspace pressure and the delta P correspond to the normal operating conditions at that Brix from practical experience. Hence, you can see that the highest juice level selected for a given Brix increases with the increase in Brix, which is 50 for 20, 60% of tube height for 35 Brix and 70% of tube height for 70 Brix. I'll just give you a description of the procedure that was when the testing was undertaken. So water was boiled from a cold start to warm up the evaporator rig to get it to normal operating conditions. The juice was sucked in into the rig using vacuum. Although the use of vacuum was kept to a minimum to decrease the flashing of to avoid the flashing of juice inside the evaporator rig and increase the Brix. Testing was commenced when the juice was in equilibrium with the headspace pressure. The data was logged for calendar pressure, headspace pressure, the juice tank temperature, the condensate return temperature, and the condensate height in the condensate containers below. Alright, so the experimental program was undertaken in two stages. The original test had 432 tests for all the 9 tubes. To understand the interaction between tube length and tube diameter, replicates were undertaken and 128 data points were achieved from that replicates. So the figure on your right shows the evaporator rig when a 4 meter tube was operating. This the entire evaporator rig was close to 6 meter high. This is the control box which controls the operating conditions in the evaporator and the computer which was logging all the data. There was around 2 meters of evaporator rig below this ground, and the condensate containers were actually below the evaporator rig. Alright, so this slide shows the condensate measurements. The graph on your left shows the condensate measurements for a medium diameter 2 meter tube. It can be seen that steady state condensate collection is achieved for all the 4 sections with the M2 tube, which concludes that the boiling was good and the entire tube was wetted. We do get some condensate collection on the inner sides of the steam chest due to heat losses. Now the figure on your right shows the condensate collection measurements from a large diameter and a 4 meter tube. It can be seen that juice was boiling on the bottommost section of the tube. Juice was boiling at the bottommost section of the tube, and not much heat transfer was achieved at the top 3 sections. Alright, so the heat transfer calculation for the whole tube is the average heat transfer coefficients of the 4 sections of the tube. So if you look at the figure on your right, which is the industrial tube, this shows the magnified condensate flow pattern along the length of the tube, which starts from a laminar and then goes into a turbulent flow. Now, because of the gutters in the experimental tube, this condensate flow pattern has been disturbed, and this is what the condensate flow pattern would look like in an experimental tube. Hence, The average heat transfer coefficient experiences reduced resistance of condensate than industrial evaporators. A correction factor was required so that the results from the experimental rig tube can be transferred to an industrial tube without any gutters. This correction factor was based on the steam side condensation heat transfer. All right, so let's discuss some of the results of heat transfer coefficient for an M2 tube. So this figure shows overall heat transfer coefficient for the whole tube for medium diameter 2 meter length at two different headspace pressures and two different delta P for 20 bricks. So it can be seen that as when as juice level percent tube height increases, the heat transfer coefficient increases. It reaches a optimum juice level, which corresponds to a maximum heat transfer coefficient, and there is a fall in heat transfer coefficient if operated above or below this level. Now, the data here shows that there's a strong influence of juice level above, below the optimum juice level, affecting the heat transfer coefficient. If you look at the results for heat transfer coefficient for the whole tube for a small diameter and a 2 meter length tube, we can see as we increase the juice level, the heat transfer coefficient increases, and an increase in juice level about the optimum causes a steep decline in heat transfer coefficient for a small diameter 2 meter length tube. Now this is one of the new results that we have found out from the study, where there's a strong influence above the optimum juice level for a small diameter. Now, all of these results were placed together, and the optimum juice level where the maximum heat transfer coefficient was achieved was reported. Hence, now we are looking at the heat transfer coefficient maximum for 20 bricks. So, the figure on your right shows the all the 9 tube dimensions with HTC max results for 20 bricks. So we have 38.1 and 44.45 tube diameter at 2 meter and 3 meter length, giving us a heat transfer coefficient which is above the benchmark of 3000 watts per meter square per Kelvin. The interesting result is the 50.8 millimeter diameter, which has a high heat transfer coefficient at 2 meter length. With a slight decrease with a 3 meter length, there's a steep decline in heat transfer coefficient when a 50.8 millimeter diameter and 4 meter tube length is used. This slide shows the HTC max results for 35 bricks. We have an interesting result here where the medium diameter 44.45 and 38.1 diameter for a 3 meter tube length have shown to be significantly higher heat transfer coefficient than a 2 meter length. Increasing the length about 3 meters, there's a decline in heat transfer coefficient for both of these diameters. Again, the large diameter has a reasonably good heat transfer coefficient at 2 meters, but any increase in length about 2 meters, there's a drop in heat transfer coefficient with the large diameters. Alright, so the HTC max results for 70 bricks, it can be very clearly seen that there are good heat transfer coefficient results with a 2 meter length for all the 3 diameters, but an increase in tube length about 2 meters, there's a drop in heat transfer coefficient and diameter does not have much of an effect. So it could be concluded that having a long tube towards the tail end of the vessel is not beneficial from the heat transfer point of view. All right, in understanding the interaction between headspace pressure and the delta P, the figure on your right shows headspace pressure and delta P interaction for 20 bricks, 35 bricks, and 70 bricks. So an increase in headspace pressure increases the heat transfer coefficient for 20 and 35 bricks, but it's much more complicated when it comes to 70 bricks. Delta P is not found to be much significant for 20 and 35 bricks, but is found to be more significant when operating at 70 bricks. Alright, so summarizing the results for heat transfer coefficient max, bricks has the most significant effect on heat transfer coefficient, which can be seen in these slides, where we have heat transfer coefficient about 3000 for 20 bricks, heat transfer coefficient between 1000 and 2500 for 35 bricks, and heat transfer coefficient between 500 to 700 for 70 bricks. Heat transfer coefficient was higher at higher headspace pressure, which is a higher boiling temperature, owing to the reduced viscosity of the juice. Small diameter is preferred for long tubes, which is 3 meter and higher. And in conclusion, the small diameter 3 meter tube and medium diameter 3 meter tube dimensions are recommended for as a first, second and third effect in a quintuple set based on the heat transfer performance. Alright, so trying to understand the optimum juice level, it is found that bricks has the most significant effect on affecting the optimum juice level. The figure on your right shows the effect of all the parameters on juice level. The graph contains data from 432 tests, which shows that the optimum juice level for 20 bricks is around 30%. And as the bricks of the juice increases, the optimum juice level increases around 45% to at 35 bricks and 55 to 60% at 70 bricks. Now if we choose one particular bricks, let's say 20 bricks, it is the tube diameter which determines the optimum juice level. So we have a lower optimum juice level for a smaller diameter and higher optimum juice levels for 44 and 51 diameter. Headspace pressure and delta P have found to have very small effect on optimum juice level. Alright, so coming to the second objective of phase two is to develop a regression model for heat transfer coefficient. So this has been the first attempt to put together a regression model for heat transfer coefficient with all the tube dimensions studied in this work. The equation came to be a function of bricks, a vapor condensation coefficient, tube length and tube diameter. The scatter is large for higher VCC results as can be seen in this graph. As I said, that this is the first attempt where all the tube dimensions are included into the regression model, and work is still going on to improve this regression model. All right, so coming to the third objective of the phase two of the work, in understanding the boiling mechanism in rising film evaporation, it is well known that the resistance on the juice side contributes 70% of the total resistance to heat transfer. This resistance changes with change in the flow regime inside the tube. Now, formation of these flow regimes have been studied extensively in the past, but the effect of tube dimension and operating condition on these flow regimes are not yet investigated. Alright, so this figure shows the formation of the flow regimes inside a single tube where the fluid is entering from the bottom of the vessel. So at the bottommost where we have the liquid is the single phase forced convection heat transfer. As the liquid rises above the tube, bubbles start to form and this gives rise to bubbly flow. As the liquid rises above in the tube, these bubbles coalesce together until they reach the diameter of the tube, giving rise to slug flow. Now, nucleate boiling is the dominant form of heat transfer during the bubbly and the slug flow. As these bubbles rise higher in the tube, they become a liquid film along the circumference of the tube with the vapor core located in the center, giving rise to annular flow. Now, interfacial vaporization is the dominant form of heat transfer during the annular flow. As the liquid film rises above the tube, it becomes thinner and thinner, finally going into mist region where the film is no longer available on the along the surface of the wall, and liquid is present as droplets in the vapor space. Now the graph on your right shows the heat transfer coefficient increasing in the left direction. So it can be seen that heat transfer coefficient increases as going from the forced convection to new bubbly and slug flow and to annular flow, and then there's a drop in heat transfer coefficient when it goes into mist region. Since most of the vessels are operated with a bit of dynamic level above the tube plate, ensuring that the tubes are fully wetted, it can be said that the factory vessels only operate until the annular flow and rarely would go into the mist flow. All right, so these flow regimes is one theory in trying to understand the flow regimes inside the tube and this resistance to heat transfer. As we said that this with this experimental work, we have collected the condensate from four sections of the tube in trying to understand the heat transfer along the length of the tube. Now the individual section heat transfer coefficient will assist in understanding the boiling mechanism along the length of the tube. So the figure on your right shows the heat transfer coefficient for all the four sections, the overall heat transfer coefficient, and the overall corrected heat transfer coefficient for industrial tubes. So this figure is for 20 bricks with two Hesperus pressures and two delta P's vertically. So if you look at the green line, which is the heat transfer coefficient for the bottommost section, which is section 4, the heat transfer coefficient increases from the green to the blue line, which is the section 3 just above it, and increases further to the section 2, which is just above it. Now there's a drop in heat transfer coefficient from section 2 to section 1, although the drop is not that significant and is accountable from the error. Now this is one pattern of heat transfer coefficient results that we have observed from the evaporator rig. There's another pattern that we have observed from the evaporator rig is that there's a decrease in heat transfer coefficient along the length of the tube. If you look at this same figure on your right, the heat transfer coefficient for section 4 is around 6000 watts per meter square per Kelvin and drops to around 2000 watts per meter square per Kelvin for the section 3, which is just above it. There is again a rise in heat transfer coefficient from section 3 to section 2 and section 1. Now these results have formed to be 20 or 25% of the total results showing this sort of behavior. Boiling crisis is identified to be the possible cause of this phenomenon. It is aimed to understand the effect of tube dimension and operating condition on boiling crisis. All right, so what is boiling crisis? If you look at the figure on your right, from A to B, the single phase heat transfer takes place and the heat transfer to the tube increases. From B to C region, there's subcooled nuclear boiling, which is bubbly flow. And C to D, there is saturated nuclear boiling, which is slug flow. And heat transfer to the tube increases from B to D. At point D, a point comes where it says it's from departure from nuclear boiling, and there's a drop in heat transfer coefficient from D to E. If you look at the figure on your left, it shows the heat transfer, heating surface, and the formation of bubbles on the heating surface, and the direction of flow, which is from the bottom to top. The heat transfer starts here, which is called as the bubbly flow, and gives rise to slug flow in this region. Now, any drop in a local pressure at this point causes an increased bubble population, which causes a bubble crowding along the heating surface. The liquid which is here, this bubble layer acts as an insulating material to the liquid here, and this is where the critical heat flux or boiling crisis occurs from point D to point E and causes a drop in heat transfer coefficient. It is said that there is post boiling crisis heat transfer can occur, and heat transfer will go into from E to F into partial flame boiling, and then from F to G into complete flame boiling. Alright, so talking about boiling crisis or critical heat flux, critical heat flux has been extensively studied in nuclear reactors and even in sugar mill boilers, where due to critical heat flux, there is damage to the equipment such as tube bursting. Now, the occurrence of critical heat flux does not cause equipment failure or tube busting in evaporators due to the low delta T operating in the evaporators. Although critical heat flux causes a reduction in heat transfer coefficient. The theory suggests that critical heat flux increases as mass flux kilograms per meter square increases, as the tube diameter decreases, and as delta T increases. The boiling crisis or the critical heat flux model is yet to be solved for the evaporator results. All right, so that was the end of phase two with the three objectives, and work is still going on with the regression modeling and the boiling mechanism theory. Coming to the phase three of the project, which is computational fluid dynamics, CFD model is a useful tool in engineering design process and will be used in this work to understand the boiling mechanism. So the objectives in the phase three of the project is to develop a CFD model for a single tube evaporator rig, validate the CFD model with experimental results, and investigate the boiling mechanism with calendrias of different tube dimensions. Alright, so in the first attempt to put together a CFD model, the steam side of the calendria was modeled. The figure shows the steam entering the steam calendria for a half a meter section of the evaporator rig. It is seen that the velocity of the steam just around the tube surface is very low, hence confirming that the condensate that was forming on the tube was not blown away off due to the incoming high velocity of the steam, and it does not cause a localized boiling point in the tube. Alright, so the progress to date in the project phases, we have completed the capital cost model, which was the phase one of the project. In the phase two of the project, the experimental program, we have finished the experimental investigation. We have commenced the regression model, and we are trying to put together an empirical model for heat transfer coefficient and optimum juice level. And we are trying to understand the boiling mechanism in rising film evaporation at this moment. The phase three of the project has commenced, which is the CFD modeling, and we have put together the steam side modeling. Next is to work on the two-phase model inside the tube. So the future work in the final year of this PhD is to investigate flow regimes, taking into account the critical heat flux model, complete the CFD model for the single tube rig, selection of the optimum design, that is outputs from the CFD model and the cost model for a given heating duty, and publishing and presenting of final thesis. I'd like to thank my supervisor team, Professor Ross Broadfoot, Associate Professor Jeff Kent, and Dr. Florent Plaza for all their advice and assistance through this big investigation. I'd like to thank the bioprocessing staff and the staff from the School of Chemistry, Physics, and Mechanical Engineering at KUT for all their assistance and advice in analyzing the data. I'd like to thank Sugar Research Australia and Sugar Research Institute for the financial support of this project. And I'd like to thank Rocky Point Mill Management and staff, especially Bruce Tyson, mill manager at Rocky Point, for the permission to undertake my experimental work at Rocky Point Mill, and for all their assistance throughout this investigation. Thank you.